And first, Cokie Roberts is coming here April 15th. Check out our website. You can sign up for these as they come along. So it's starting out to be a very, very a good year. There'll be a book signing as usual in the atrium following the lecture, and the books, of course, are available for sale. If you would just give our speaker a couple of seconds, give him a 60-second delay or a two-minute delay so he can get back around out to the atrium to sign the books for you instead of running up and grabbing him before he gets there, would help us a lot. And be available online as a webcast on the Atlanta Forum Network at www.atlantaforumnetwork.org. Robert Dallek is a delightful man. We've just spent some time with him. He's the author of An Unfinished Life, John F. Kennedy, 1917 to 1963, which was number one bestseller on the New York Times bestseller list. His writings appeared in The Atlantic, The New York Times, and The Washington Post. He's an elected fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and of the Society of American Historians, for which he served as president 2004-2005. He lives in Washington, D.C. Please welcome Robert Dallek.
Thank you so much. It's wonderful to be back here at the Atlanta History Center. I remember speaking here when I brought up my Kennedy book, and it was great fun, and always get these nice introductions, and they put me in mind, I must say, of an introduction I had several years back when I was lecturing in the Soviet Union. My host on that occasion, who I like to think had an imperfect command of English, introduced me by saying, "Professor Dallek is the author of several distinguished works. They're the kinds of books that once you put them down, you can't pick them up again." Not music to the author's ears. I also like to begin these lectures with another anecdote, which is about my son, who is now 37. But back when he was about, 4, maybe 5 years old at most, he said to me one day, "Daddy," he said, "you're a doctor, aren't you?" And I said, "Well, yes, but not like your doctor, not like your pediatrician." And he said, "Oh, I know that because you're also an historian." Well, I was so pleased that he could make this distinction at so tender an age. But then he wanted to know, "Does that mean that you make people in the past feel better?" That would be known as a methodological breakthrough, I guess. So let's see if I can make Richard Nixon feel any better tonight. I don't think so, and I already know that Henry Kissinger doesn't feel much better from the results of this published book. Several years ago, actually in 1994-95, I was something called visiting Holmesworth professor at Oxford in England. And the BBC asked me to come on the air on the radio to participate in a discussion with a British author by the name of John Cholmley, who had written extensively on Winston Churchill. And Cholmley was a fierce critic of Churchill and of FDR's, and thought that they had been responsible for dismantling the British Empire. And he just lit into both of them. Well, we got into quite a debate. At the end of this discussion, our host said, "Nothing I like better than a good punch-up between two academics." Well, at one point, we started arguing about documents and who had read more documents. And he said, "I've read more documents on this Roosevelt period than you ever will." And so I said to him, "Well, you remind me of what Harry Truman said about Richard Nixon. He may have read the Constitution, but he sure as hell didn't understand it." That argument put me in mind of what a great Dutch historian once said, Peter Gale, that history is argument without end. We're always debating the past. We still talk about the origins of the American Civil War, the consequences of World War II, why we got into World War I, the peacemaking, constantly reshuffling in our judgments of these presidential administrations. We were talking at dinner about the fact when Harry Truman left office in 1953, his approval rating was 32%. And now he's seen as one of the, if not great, one of the near great presidents of American history. So the perspective changes. And part of the reason why it changes is because historians gain access to new materials, new documents, fresh materials. Abraham Lincoln's papers, for example, were locked up in the library, locked up by his family until 1947. And it was only then that they came into the possession of the Library of Congress and that historians could begin to use, biographers could begin to use the family papers to write in much greater depth about Lincoln, you see. And so when you come to a book like this one I've written, you begin with the idea that you need access to materials, to documents. What we like to do is, as historians, 30 years after a presidential administration, you want to have access to that body of internal discussions, memos, debates. You want to see what really went on. Because all these presidents want you to think they walk on water, they do no wrong, they have no flaws, no weaknesses. And, of course, once you get into the documentary record, you can see how human, of course, they are and how many misjudgments they make and how much anguish they suffer in trying to perform effectively in that job as president. When I came to this Nixon-Kissinger project, I had my doubts as to whether I was going to be able to do it because up to that juncture, the Nixon administration was the most secretive in American history. Up to that point. And I wasn't sure that I was going to be able to produce the kind of work that I had done on Franklin Roosevelt, on John Kennedy, on Lyndon Johnson. And to my amazement, it turns out that this Nixon presidency is the most transparent in American presidential history. It's amazing. What was there? A huge body of materials, which put me in historian's heaven, as they say. First off, there are the Richard Nixon tapes. He never intended for the public to have these or for historians to have access to them, but of course Watergate changed all that. And there are 3,700 hours of Nixon tapes, 3,700 hours, that were made over 2.5 years. February 1971, July of 1973, when it was revealed in the Watergate hearings that there were these tapes, and they cut off recording conversations. See, in fact, only 2,800 hours of the tapes are now open. There are still 900 hours of Nixon tapes that will come to hand in the future, not because archivists are trying to hide anything, but because the material is so difficult to work your way through to review them for privacy concerns and national security concerns. And so in the future, 900 hours of additional 900 hours of tapes will come to hand. But believe me, 2,800 hours is more than you'd ever care to listen to. And especially when you hear Richard Nixon, The vulgarity, I cannot repeat to you. It's too embarrassing. Really, the things he would say, it's just amazing. Extraordinarily bright man, very adept, thoughtful about foreign policy, and also an extraordinary vulgarian. On top of these 2,800 hours of Nixon conversations, there are now 20,000 pages of Henry Kissinger's telephone transcripts. Kissinger had locked up these papers in the Library of Congress till 5 years after he died. And then there was to be a committee that would review requests to get into this material. Well, about 5-6 years ago, the Historical Division of the State Department, which publishes a series called Fruits, Foreign Relations in the United States, it's a great old diplomatic document series going back to 1869. And they came to Kissinger and said, we cannot publish authoritative volumes on the Nixon presidency, on the Nixon foreign policy, without your papers. We have to have access. Well, apparently hemmed and hawed, and he finally gave in. And so these 20,000 pages of materials came to hand. And the puzzle to me, frankly, is why he kept so many of these materials, why he left them for historians, biographers to read, as you'll see from my talk as I go along here. In addition to the Nixon tapes and the Kissinger transcripts, there are 800,000 pages of national security files, 800,000 pages. And that's only the beginning of wisdom. There'll be more in the future. I mean, people say to me, oh, my, this is this big book. This will be the definitive study. And there is no such thing. There's always going to be additional work. And good, because we have a different perspective from the present time. We always do. And there'll be this vast body of additional materials that will deepen our understanding and ability to reconstruct that presidential administration. Finally, there's something called the H.R. Bob Haldeman CD-ROM diaries. Now, Haldeman, of course, was Nixon's chief of staff, ousted in April of 1973 over Watergate, but he left behind this very detailed, very rich diary of what was going on in that administration. Part of it was published several years back, but the CD-ROM version in the archives is much more detailed and much more revealing, particularly about the Nixon-Kissinger relationship. So with all these materials, I began with what any historian would begin, asking a question. And the question, first of all, was, were Nixon and Kissinger really thoughtful, effective, wise foreign policy leaders? And the answer I came up with was yes and no. There were some exceptional achievements. First of all, the opening to China. Nixon understood that you could not isolate 800 million Chinese forever. And for all his anti-communism, all his talk about China as a deadly adversary, the minute he got into the White House, he began pumping for the idea that we needed to establish a new relationship with the Chinese. Part of it was because he also understood that nuclear weapons were not usable weapons. He believed, and Kissinger did too, in the doctrine of mad, mutually assured destruction. It was pointless. You couldn't fight a war with the Soviets or anybody and use these nuclear weapons without destroying the United States as well. And so, or at least a significant part of it. And so he and Kissinger agreed that you needed to arrive at some kind of accommodation called détente with the Soviet Union. And the way to do it was in part to use pressure on the Soviets from a new relationship between the United States and China. And it was very shrewd, very wise. And the Soviets jumped to this possibility, at this possibility. And not only did Nixon go to China, but of course then he went to the Soviet Union and reached a trade agreement with them, SALT I, Strategic Arms Limitation Treaty. And so here were really big, substantial gains in foreign policy, putting in place what Nixon and Kissinger called the structure of peace. Thirdly, I would say, there was the shuttle diplomacy following the Yom Kippur War in October of 1973. Kissinger mainly central to this, and that opened the door to Jimmy Carter's later Camp David peace accords between Egypt and Israel. Without Kissinger having done that shuttle diplomacy, I don't think Carter would have been able to achieve the agreement between Israel and Egypt. Kissinger, of course, won the Nobel Peace Prize for the Vietnam peace negotiations. I don't think it ever should have been the case. You'll see when I talk about Vietnam in a couple of minutes. He deserved it for the Middle East negotiations, for having made that substantial stride forward. So having seen this material, reached the conclusion that here were some striking achievements, the question remained, the big question to me remained, why did Nixon fail? Why was he forced out? Why should he have been the only president in the country's history to have been compelled to resign? Now, on the surface, of course, the answer is Watergate. Watergate trapped him out, caught him in a cover-up, unconstitutional, illegal performance behavior, and he's forced out. My argument to you is that Watergate was more the symptom than the cause. The real cause of Nixon's demise was an atmosphere of deception, of double-dealing, backbiting, hidden machinations, paranoia that suffused the Nixon administration. And that kind of double-dealing, deception, manipulation, really begins with the Nixon-Kissinger relationship. Let me try and make it clear what I mean. When Nixon appointed Kissinger his national security advisor in the end of 1968, after being elected, he really didn't know Henry. He knew his reputation. He knew that this was someone who was a distinguished academic with major publications, books and articles on foreign policy, on nuclear weapons, on national security, but he really didn't know him. Nixon appointed a man named William Rogers as his Secretary of State. Rogers was a former associate in a law firm in New York who didn't know a hell of a lot about foreign policy, and that's exactly what Nixon wanted, because he wanted to control the making of foreign policy. And he appoints Kissinger in the same spirit. Here is this fellow from Harvard, a thoughtful academic, who'll feed him ideas, he'll be able to have serious discussions with, but he has this German accent. He's not going to be a public personality. He'll be in the background, you see. This is Nixon's assumption. Well, very quickly, he begins to learn that Kissinger was anything but a wallflower, an academic wallflower. He should have known the anecdote that people at Harvard would tell about Kissinger. One day during the summer when he was teaching there, he was walking on the campus and he saw an assistant of his from one of the courses he was teaching sitting with a very attractive young woman, English young woman, who was an aspiring journalist. And Kissinger went up to both of them, starts chatting, and she was very cool with him, very standoffish, and it angered him. And he said, "Why don't you like me?" And she said, "Because you're a fascist." And he said, "A fascist? Why, I was in the invasion of Belgium." And she said, "Really? With which army?" Nixon came to enjoy the anecdote about when some journalists asked Kissinger about the fact that he could not run for president since he was foreign-born. And Kissinger replied, "Yes, but the Constitution says nothing about my being emperor." Nixon found it very revealing, because this was the experience he began to have with Kissinger. The tensions between the two became palpable. Kissinger would push to control foreign policy on the Middle East, on Vietnam, on Soviet relations, Chinese relations, and he was constantly on the attack against Bill Rogers. Now, Nixon didn't hold a brief for Rogers, but he didn't want Kissinger pushing Rogers out the administration. and he didn't want him establishing too much authority. Here's a conversation Nixon has with H.R. Haldeman about Kissinger. He said, "Henry's personality problem is just too goddamn difficult for us to deal with." He and Haldeman talk constantly about what they call the K problem, the Kissinger problem. "God damn it, Bob, he's," meaning Kissinger, "he's psychopathic about trying to screw Rogers." Haldeman agreed and warned that if Kissinger, quote, "wins the battle with Rogers, he may not be livable with afterward." Nixon thought he would become, quote, unquote, "a dictator." "Did you know that Henry worries every time I talk on the telephone with anybody? He feels he must be present any time I see anybody important." Nixon complained that Kissinger had all these goddamn NSC discussions about every goddamn little shit-ass thing. This is a quote, by the way. That happens. "He has too many meetings. They go on and on and on and on about crap." The President of the United States. Nixon resented Kissinger's assertiveness. And he resented the fact that after he sent him on the secret mission to China, as a prelude to Nixon going there in February of 1972, it became known. They let it out to the press. And Henry became something of a celebrity. He became, in some respects, the public face of the administration in foreign policy. And Nixon was furious. He couldn't stand it. He, in some ways, was justified in that he was the one who really had the idea and the initiative about China, and Kissinger was more his instrument. But Henry's the one who's getting all this credit. When they go to China in February 72, and the plane lands, and Nixon is about to get off the plane, he turns to everybody, including Kissinger, and says, "You all stay back. You stay back." He wanted to come off the plane and be seen at the top of the ramp, see, or staircase, with the photographers snapping the picture. It's Richard Nixon. He's arrived. He's opening the door to China. And Henry Kissinger is nowhere to be seen. See, Kissinger understood the resentment that Nixon felt toward him over this whole business. Indeed, what's so striking is how Nixon would begin taunting Kissinger. He'd call him behind his back and occasionally to his face, "My Jew boy." And he'd say to him ugly things about Jews, and he'd say to him, "Isn't that right, Henry? Isn't that right?" And Kissinger would say, "Well, Mr. President, there are Jews and there are Jews." See, they talk about the Middle East at a National Security Council discussion. And Kissinger would give his opinion. And Nixon would say then, "All right, now can we get an American opinion?" See, just nastiness between the two. Kissinger reciprocated. He reciprocated. Behind the scenes, he'd call Nixon the meatball mind, our drunken friend, the maniac, a raving maniac. During Watergate, he said to Al Haig, who was, Nixon's chief of staff by then, having replaced Haldeman, he'd say to Haig, "The president has to give a speech in which he appears to be the father of his country, not some goddamn raving maniac." See, he would talk about him that way. He resented the people close to Nixon. There's a conversation I found in British documents that he had with the British ambassador in which he says to him that these people around Nixon are the biggest bunch of self-serving bastards I've ever seen. And he just is so indiscreet in the kinds of things that he would say to people. And it was the expression, one can only assume, of his anger, of his irritation. Well, the tension between the two really mounted in 1973 during the Yom Kippur War. Nixon now is deep in the throes of the Watergate crisis. His capacity to govern, to lead, has been severely eroded. When the war erupts, Kissinger essentially takes over and runs foreign policy. He hears on the morning of October 5th, I guess is the morning it began, 6 o'clock in the morning, he gets a call. He doesn't speak to Nixon for over 3 hours. Nixon is in Florida. He doesn't call him. When he does call him, Nixon is almost plaintive in asking Kissinger to tell the press that he has been briefing the president on events in the Middle East every hour in order to encourage the assumption that Richard Nixon is still very much in charge of foreign policy. A week into the war, Brent Scowcroft, who is now Kissinger's deputy at the National Security Council, calls Kissinger up at 5 to 8 in the evening, and he says to him, Henry, the British Prime Minister wants to speak to the President in half an hour. And Kissinger said, Brent, we can't do it. The President is loaded. He's drunk. He doesn't have the wherewithal to get on the phone with the Prime Minister. And he'll have to talk to him in the morning. And Kissinger says, but in the meantime, I'll talk to the Prime Minister. 2 weeks later, the Israelis have surrounded the Egyptian Third Army in the Sinai, and that army is in danger of collapse, of being forced into a surrender. The Soviets are almost hysterical about this possibility. They've invested hugely in psychologically and in arms, helping the Egyptians, and they call Kissinger, and they tell him that they intend to send a paratroop brigade into the Middle East, into Sinai, to, in essence, preserve that Third Army. And they want the United States to do a joint exercise with them, joint military exercise. Kissinger and Haig, on the telephone, 10 to 10 in the evening, talk about this. And there's just no way they're going to allow the Soviets to get into the Middle East with a paratroop brigade. And Haig says to Kissinger, well, you're going to have a meeting about this. And Kissinger says, yes. Where will you meet? And Kissinger says, at the State Department. Kissinger is now Secretary of State. And Haig says, no, no, you must meet at the President's house at the White House, because they're very concerned, he's very concerned, that if the press gets wind of this meeting, they want the press to think that the President was there, involved, directly telling people at this meeting what our policy would be. Well, Kissinger, in this conversation, 10 in the evening, says to Haig, all right, he says, well, where's the President? And Haig says, he's asleep. And Kissinger said, oh, should we wake him up? Haig says, no, I'm in charge here. But he didn't. Just interpolating now. I want to be an honest historian. He didn't say that then. But he said, no, we shouldn't wake him up. A half an hour later, they talk again. And Haig says to Kissinger, well, did you talk to the President? They don't trust each other. And Haig says, did you talk to the President? Kissinger says, no. He says, I don't want him charging around here. They then go ahead. 7 unelected officials, led by Kissinger and Haig, and they agree to raise the DEFCON, the defense condition, the nuclear alert. This happened only twice in the Cold War. The first time under Kennedy during the Cuban Missile Crisis, and the second time during this Yom Kippur War, October 25, 1973. The next morning, or next early afternoon, there's another telephone transcript of a conversation between Haig and Kissinger. Haig says to him, because they've just heard that the Soviets now are backing down in the face of this American stance, nuclear alert. The first person Kissinger talks to is not Nixon, but Haig. And Haig says to him again, have you talked to the President? He said, no, I'll be calling him shortly. But then they say, we don't want the press to think, quote unquote, we cooked this up, which of course they did. Kissinger denies it. He was giving a lecture at the U.S. Naval Academy, and somebody told me that a midshipman stood up and asked him about the fact that I had published an article in Vanity Fair in which I discussed this development. What do you think of what Dallek said there? And Kissinger said, he's mistaken. It's not true. We consulted Nixon. I don't believe it. I asked at the archives, is there a single document, a single piece of evidence that would undercut what I found in these telephone conversations, these telephone transcripts? There's nothing there. They did this. And that's why they didn't want the press to think they cooked it up. Now, I don't doubt for a minute that they believed they were reflecting Nixon's judgment. And I don't doubt also that Nixon probably would have gone along with this or even encouraged it, you see. But the man either was on sedatives or was drunk and couldn't be consulted. He was so incapacitated, and so Kissinger gladly and Haig gladly take over and run with this authority, you see. A couple of weeks later, Kissinger is on the shuttle diplomacy track. He sends a cable back to Haig and Scowcroft and says, if you think this information will disturb the president, don't show it to him. See? Well, the resentment that was generated here by what Kissinger was doing, Scowcroft, who I interviewed, told me that Nixon complained repeatedly about how Henry was running away with power. But he couldn't do anything because he was a crippled president. And Kissinger was the positive face of the administration. He was Super K, news magazines, Time, Newsweek, celebrating his standing, his influence, his importance, you see. And Kissinger, Nixon could not get rid of him, and he resented it. The night before Nixon resigned, he had a conversation with Gerald Ford, who was going to become president the next day. And he said to him, Jerry, you got to keep Henry on. He's vital for our national security, for our foreign policy. But every once in a while, you got to kick him in the nuts. Otherwise, he's going to run away with power. Again, quote from Richard Nixon. Well, after the presidency, Kissinger was up in Canada, invited there by some MPs, members of parliament. And one of them asked him what he really thought of Richard Nixon. And he kind of laid into him, was candid. He didn't know a microphone was open. And it was recorded, see. And it got back into the press. And so when he got back to the United States, he called Nixon and apologized to him. And not long after that, they met at Hubert Humphrey's funeral. And Nixon said to him, well, Henry, are you still so mean? And Kissinger said, yes, Mr. President, but I don't have as many opportunities. It was ugly. But how then could Kissinger have survived? The way he survived with all this was an understanding that Nixon was a profoundly insecure man and that what he needed to do was to constantly reassure him. And in these tapes and in these transcripts, what you see is Kissinger stroking Nixon like crazy, telling him, Mr. President, without you, this country would be dead. You never think in small terms. You always think in big terms, in big policy ideas, you see. Let me give you one quote from one of these conversations. In June 73, throws the Watergate again, Kissinger told Nixon about the Democratic senators pressing the Watergate investigation, and I quote, those bastard traitors we have in this country, those bastards are now trying to deprive you of any success, he told Nixon. When Nixon said he had plans, he had no plan to resign, Kissinger responded, quote, a resignation would be a national catastrophe, Mr. President. You can go down in history as the man who brought about the greatest revolution in foreign policy ever in the history of this country. See? So Nixon was so vulnerable to this. He needed that reassurance. He was so insecure. The last night they were in China in February 72, they're in Shanghai in a posh hotel. Nixon has a suite of rooms. He's been drinking Mao Tais all afternoon and evening, and he's sloshed. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, he calls Kissinger and Haldeman to come to his suite of rooms. And he's practically begging them to assure him that this China mission will be seen as a great success. What I say in the book is that Nixon was the sort of fellow who could not take yes for an answer. He needed to have a crisis. He was much more comfortable in a crisis than he ever was
with any success he had. And he was so insecure, though, about all manner of things. And as he would say during the presidency, this job would be fine if it weren't for people. It's an amazing statement. The guy was a career politician. How did he go through political life? He had this aversion. He was a kind of lonely, a loner, someone who avoided people as much as he could. And yet, the dilemma or puzzle is, why was he so successful as a politician, which he was, winning House seats, Senate seats, the vice presidency twice? Yes, he lost the presidency to Kennedy, and he lost the governorship race in California in 62 to Pat Brown. But he wins the presidency twice, and the second time in 72, he wins one of the great landslides in American presidential history. I think the answer to it is that he was extraordinarily astute at reading public mood. He understood where the public was at a given moment in time. When he ran for the House, the Senate, vice president, president, and he was able to strike resonant chords with millions and millions of people. Of course, as the Greeks used to say, fate is character. And in a sense, he was brought down by his flawed character, by his paranoia, by his deceptiveness, by his machinations. So here you have the beginnings, so to speak, of this deception, of this manipulation between Nixon and Kissinger. What they had was a kind of unhappy marriage. They had to get along. They collaborated. They did some brilliant things, but they were also very much at each other's throats. And it resonated very much in some of the policies they followed. Let me give you just two examples. First, Vietnam. Vietnam. As soon as they came to office, they knew that if Nixon were going to be reelected, they needed to end the war to get the 545,000 American troops out of Vietnam by November of 72. They have a conversation. I quote, Nixon said to Kissinger, "In Saigon, there's the tendency to believe that we can fight the war to victory, but you and I know it won't happen. It's impossible." So, 69, they see the war, victory in the war, as impossible, and yet it goes on for four more years. Some 23,000 more American troops perish, tens of thousands of Vietnamese, Cambodians, and Laotians. And so the question is, why do they do it? Why sustain this war effort if they're convinced that victory is out of reach? Well, several things operated. One was the hope that American military muscle, if exercised forcefully enough, could compel the North Vietnamese to make what Nixon came to call peace with honor, could compel them to make a peace agreement which would allow for enduring South Vietnamese autonomy and honor the American war effort. They fail at this, of course. The Cambodian incursion. In 1971, they encouraged the South Vietnamese to battle with the North Vietnamese in Laos, and the South Vietnamese take a real serious beating. In December 1972, they undertake the Christmas bombing, which does, in fact, force the North Vietnamese to the peace table to make a final agreement in January of 73. But this military muscle, this exercise of military power, we used more tonnage, dropped more tonnage from the air on North Vietnam than we did in all the theaters of World War II. That was the extent to which the bombing took place. And it didn't work in the following sense, that we couldn't save South Vietnam. There was also the hope that something called Vietnamization, they'll stand up while we stand down. Sound familiar? The hope was that the South Vietnamese could be trained to fight effectively. Well, in this 71 conflict, which I mentioned just now, between the South and North Vietnamese in Laos, the North Vietnamese handed them their heads. And Nixon was furious. And you have these taped conversations in which he's cursing them out. Goddamn South Vietnamese, if only they could take one F Hill. If only they could capture a couple of prisoners. Why don't they use their Air Force to bomb? They keep talking about they can't bomb North Vietnamese trucks because they're, quote-unquote, moving targets. He said it's ridiculous, and he curses them. But the bottom line is he knows that this Vietnamization is not working and that the likelihood is that South Vietnam is not going to be able to survive once the United States leaves the war. Kissinger knows this. And during the course of those 4 years, there are two striking conversations that I found, one with the Soviet ambassador Anatoly Dobrynin and the other with the Chinese premier Zhou Enlai, in which Kissinger, in essence, says that we need from the North Vietnamese to give us a decent interval. He doesn't use that term, but that's what it adds up to. For a year and a half after we get out, he doesn't want the North Vietnamese to stage an all-out offensive. Wait, because by then, the United States will have taken its distance. He assures Dobrynin and Zhou Enlai that we won't go back in. You see, give us a decent interval is what he's talking about. The reason also they don't get out is because they're very worried about the impact on Nixon's reelection. There's a conversation in the Haldeman diaries. In December of 1970, Haldeman tells Kissinger, the president wants to get out of Vietnam by the end of 1971. And Kissinger says, it's a bad idea. If we do it, and South Vietnam is unstable in 72, it could jeopardize the president's reelection. So part of the motivation is this cynical judgment on what will happen in the 72 election, the politics. There is also this idea that we're going to get peace with honor, which at least in terms of public relations, it's going to encourage the idea that we did what we had to do and that American credibility will not in any way be undermined. They're very worried about American credibility. Kissinger knows that when they make this so-called peace with honor, he tells Nixon, who's going to give a speech to the public announcing the peace agreement, and he tells the president, do not describe it as lasting, because he knows, he believes, it's not going to last. Here's a conversation Kissinger had with Stuart Alsop, distinguished Washington journalist. Kissinger said the president was engaged, in relation to Vietnam, in a sleight-of-hand performance comparable to De Gaulle's action in ending the Algerian War. Kissinger called De Gaulle a great illusionist who had staged a retreat from North Africa in a way that made France look more powerful than it actually was. Alsop said, quote, I've compared Nixon on Vietnam to the Wizard of Oz. His great clouds of rhetoric designed to conceal the fact that he has embarked on the greatest retreat in history. Kissinger agreed, saying the trick is to stage a great retreat and emerge at the other end still a great power, reasonably cohesive at home. Was there judgment wise on this? I think not. I'm very critical of them in the book. I think this idea that American credibility would have been undermined by America's departure from Vietnam in 69 or 70, they could have put up the same fig leaf that they had in 1972, 73, you see. And in fact, I think our departure would have enhanced rather than undermined America's credibility, because people around the world were saying, this is a losing enterprise. The United States, to coin a phrase, is throwing good money after bad. And our departure from Vietnam meant to people around the world that we now had the resources to use in a more productive, constructive way rather than wasting them in Vietnam. And so I think if we had gotten out earlier, it would have enhanced rather than undermined the country's credibility. That's my judgment. It'll be argued about forever, I'm sure. But what you see, of course, is the extent to which there was a kind of deception that went on over this whole Vietnam business. The other piece of deception was over Chile. The minute Allende was elected in 1970, Nixon and Kissinger worked very hard to try and bar him from getting to the presidency. He won only 34% of the vote. It was a plurality. But the Chilean tradition was that the Chilean Congress, would always put in the presidency the individual who had won a plurality. There was no break with tradition here by doing that with Allende. Nixon and Kissinger tried to encourage a coup against Allende. It failed. And, of course, he goes to the presidency. In 1973, when he's toppled by Pinochet, the Chilean military, and he dies, there's a debate, did he kill himself or was he assassinated? Nobody at this point could prove one way or the other, though the speculation is that he probably was killed. Nixon and Kissinger denied emphatically that they had anything to do with this. Let me give you a conversation, brief conversation, that Nixon and Kissinger had after Allende is toppled. Quote, the Chilean thing is getting consolidated, and of course newspapers are bleeding because the pro-communist government has been overthrown, Kissinger told Nixon. Isn't that something, Nixon responded. Kissinger then said, quote, instead of celebrating, why in the Eisenhower period, we would be heroes. Nixon interjected, well, we didn't, as you know, our hand doesn't show on this one, though. Kissinger responded, we didn't do it. I mean, we helped them, created the conditions as great as possible. That is right, Nixon said. To this day, Kissinger is asked, did you have a part in toppling Allende? And his answer is, Allende toppled himself. There's some truth to it. If they had left Allende alone, I'm convinced that he would have fallen of his own weight. He was a very ineffective leader. The country was suffering economic dislocation, labor strikes, strife. He probably would have fallen of his own accord. But they put as much political, economic, financial muscle as they could into toppling Allende. They did not order the coup. They didn't tell anybody to kill Allende. But the minute Pinochet is there, the correspondence is all about, the cables are all about telling Pinochet how they're going to support him. They'll back him up. They can't do it openly at first, but they will come round and they'll really be giving him as much support as possible. So what you see here is a record of deception. And the final question I would pose, did it make a difference? Does deception of this kind count in any significant way? I would say it counts in two ways. First of all, presidents who deceive the public or try to deceive the public, in the long run, undercut themselves, destroy their own credibility, destroy their capacity to lead the country. Once it's become reasonably clear that they have not been direct, forthright with the public. Remember that joke about Lyndon Johnson? How do you know when LBJ is telling the truth, pulls his earlobe, rubs his chin? He's telling the truth. When he begins to move his lips, you know he's lying. Johnson didn't think it was funny. But, of course, it was so revealing of where the whole thing was at in terms of Johnson's presidency. The day Richard Nixon had to tell the country at a press conference, I am not a crook, was the day his presidency was over. You can't govern when you are under that kind of cloud. To conclude, James Madison said, presidents tend to tell the country what they want to hear, what people want to hear. What they should tell the public is what they need to know in order to educate, to make this a more perfect union. This is a democracy. People should be informed, educated, informed about what is going on in an administration. Now, clearly, no president is going to be able ever to tell the entire story minute to minute. But there are degrees and degrees of deception. And to bring things to the present in conclusion, there is now such a desultory mood in the country, I feel. You ask people, are we on the right track? 19% say yes. something like 67, 68% say no. It's so distressing that so many people in the country feel the government, the leadership, is misleading the country, is taking it down a path that it really doesn't want to go. When you ask people in this country who are the greatest presidents in the country's history, they'll tell you predictably Washington, Lincoln, FDR, and then who do they add? John Kennedy and Ronald Reagan. Why those two? Kennedy, after all, was there for only 1,000 days. He'll never be seen in the long haul as a truly great president. Reagan, the record is still open. We haven't gotten to those records yet. He may prove to be of that ilk, but we need much more in-depth studies to assess what his performance was in the White House. But the reason the public, I think, was so inclined to give them credit as great presidents is because there's a yearning for positive presidential leadership, a yearning for presidents they feel they can trust. Kennedy, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. Reagan, it's morning in America, the pride is back. The public sees them as hopeful, optimistic, looking toward a better day, a better future for the country. And that's what people want. They remember when Jimmy Carter, the malaise, this was so ruinous to him. The country doesn't want to hear about a malaise. It wants to hear that your leader, your president, is going to do a better job of bringing the country together and producing a better future. And that's why, finally, I would say, it's interesting to me to watch this current election and see how much someone like Obama has forged to the forefront. I'm not saying he's going to become the nominee or even would win the presidency. I don't know. But the fact that he has so much clout so quickly, has been there such a short amount of time, I think is revealing of the fact that his message about unity, about hope, about a better day, and this idea of someone who's up from the bootstraps, his is not the slave narrative, it's the immigrant narrative. And that strikes powerful resonant chords with millions and millions of people in the country. So if he ended up winning, I would not be surprised, because I think the mood in the country now is so inclined toward wanting something that gives it fresh hope, a new day, a new optimism. Anyway, thank you for being so attentive, and I'm happy to answer questions. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask you, could you explain President Nixon's vulgarity? As far as I know, he was brought up by Quaker parents. And what happened to him?
Well, I don't know exactly, but somehow he thought it was appropriate that he would be one of the boys, that this was the way to create some kind of connection to people. He was so uncomfortable with people, as I said, and one of the ways to deal with your associates was to talk this kind of bathroom language or locker room conversation. I mean, often I'd find him saying things like, as if he were the high school football coach talking to a halftime pep talk to a losing team. And, you know, full of curses and vulgarity. I'm sure you don't want me to give you chapter and verse now, do you? the things he said about the press, oh, my goodness. Now, as Sigmund Freud once said, paranoids have real enemies. And Nixon certainly did. But he also was paranoid. And he saw enemies and opponents around every corner, under every rock. And he has an enemies list. And it gets him into this thing called Watergate, see. It was so unnecessary, so foolish. After all, he won that election by a landslide. He knew he was going to win, see. So it's these guys are anomalies to me. I don't understand in the first place by why anybody wants to run. I mean, it's to be beaten up on by the press that way. Yes, sir.
I believe he was first.
Okay.
I've read this several places, and it's been hinted at. I've never
really had anyone explore it. But as I believe, the Berlin Wall was started in August of 1961.
Yes, that's right.
And there was no way that the U.S. could confront Russia, tear down the Berlin Wall, start another war. But I understand that Kennedy did an end around by heating up hostilities in Vietnam to kind of tweak the Russians. Have you ever heard anything on that?
Well, I've heard it, but I don't believe it. I mean, I studied that Kennedy presidency very closely in that book I did 4 years ago, and I looked, and I never found anything to demonstrate that he was. I mean, he could be Machiavellian and you know, very manipulative, but I wouldn't say that was one of the things that he did. I never saw any evidence of it.
In listening to you talk, I was kind of struck by some of the parallels between the era, the Nixon-Kissinger era, and what's going on today, particularly as it relates to the war in Iraq, the war in Vietnam, some of the deceptions that have gone on. Also, the perceived power of Kissinger versus Nixon and Dick Cheney today versus Bush.
Yeah.
And obviously, I don't think they have quite the same adversarial relationship, but I would just ask you to generally comment on some of or some of the parallels.
Sure.
And secondly, if I could also ask you to, with respect to your son, instead of healing people in the past, kind of look to the future and kind of extrapolate and talk about how you think this administration will ultimately be judged.
Sure.
Thanks.
You've given me a book to write. Happy to do it. First of all, as far as Cheney goes, I think this is going to be one of the most interesting vice presidencies we will have ever had to study, because there is so much inclination to believe that he was or has been so influential, so important, so powerful. But it's we're going to have to get into the documents. We're going to have to find out what was the interaction between the two men. To what extent did he push Bush in one direction or another? To what extent did Bush resent him? How did the relationship change over time? So it's something that is a work in progress, a study in progress, so to speak. Now, as far as Iraq and Vietnam goes, I published an article in the Washington Post Outlook, which is their Sunday opinion section, about a month ago now, in which I said, the article was titled, "Iraq is not like Vietnam, except when it is." And it is. I mean, Vietnamization, Iraqization, this idea that they'll stand up, we'll stand down. And I read this morning, I'm very cynical about this, 10,000 American troops fighting in the outskirts of Baghdad, these outlying provinces where they switched their energies because of the insurgents causing all sorts of mayhem there. Who's leading the attack? The American troops. Where are the Iraqi forces? There are some there. But the reports you get is that most of the units are usually undermanned. 25% of their troops don't show up. They don't want to leave their home provinces. Are they going to be any better, more effective than these South Vietnamese forces that we invested so much in training them? Look, it's now over 4 years that we've been in Iraq. We are now involved in that war longer than we were in all of World War II. Is it going to change over the next year, 2 years, 6 years, 10 years? We're not a colonial power. We're not an imperial country. The people in this country don't believe in that kind of thing. They don't want that kind of thing. So the real question, the $64 question, that's going to confront whoever becomes president in 2009, what do you do? How do you get out? Should you deceive the public and stay there for a while and then vacate, even though you may assume that it's not going to work very well? I would argue to you, and here's part of trying to predict the future, I think we'll get out at some point, and when we do, there will be greater bloodshed, and what you will end up with is a Shiite dictatorship. We will have traded in a Sunni dictatorship for a Shiite dictatorship. Now, will al-Qaeda then have a presence there? I don't believe they will. Saddam Hussein didn't want to have a state within a state, and I don't think this Shiite dictatorship will allow one either. Will it then mean that Iran has much greater expanded influence? I'm not so confident it will, as is being predicted, because there's a long history of hatred between those two countries and peoples. Yes, there are Iraqi Shiites who are tied to and close to Iranian Shiites, but there's also a lot of Iraqis, including Shiites, who are deeply antagonistic to the Iranians. So, you know, during the Vietnam War, we were told constantly the dominoes will topple. There was a mayor of Los Angeles by the name of Sam Yorty, used to say, if we don't stop them in Vietnam, we'll have to meet them on the beaches of Santa Monica. And I used to ask, who? I mean, the Chinese, the Vietnamese, they're coming over in junks. I mean, how are they getting there? I mean, maybe I shouldn't have taken him so literally. I'm a literalist. But, I mean, I do find it unnerving that there are these parallels. Finally, your question was, how do I think the Bush administration will be remembered? Well, my dear departed mother used to say, if you don't have something good to say about somebody, don't say anything. Maybe that's where I should leave it at. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. In terms of Nixon's anti-Semitism, how deep was that? Was it really, was it motivated by Kissinger? Was it his hatred of the elites? And was it part of his entire Weltanschauung, his worldview? And also in relation to that, his attitude towards people of color, particularly African Americans.
Yeah.
Did you get a feel for that?
Absolutely. You know, Kissinger and I, when I interviewed Kissinger, we talked about Nixon's anti-Semitism. And what he said, and I agree to a substantial extent, it was a kind of cultural anti-Semitism. He grew up in a very parochial setting. His status strivings were enormous. And he resented the fact that there were so many Jews in America who had succeeded, who held prominent positions, be it in government, be it in business, be it in universities, in science, in economics, Wall Street, whatever it was. And he was very resentful of that. And it was part of this kind of small town, Weltanschauung, if you will, that made him something of an anti-Semite. Now, on the other hand, of course, he had several Jews around him who were not only Kissinger, but also Leonard Garment, his counsel, also William Sapphire, who is a quite observant Jew, and Herb Stein. He had quite a number of. So now, as far as African Americans went, he was behind the scenes contemptuous of minorities. And after he was reelected in 1972, he said to Haldeman, "We got to, you know, shake up the administration. We got to bring in. We need some Hispanics and blacks, and we won't find any. We can't find any. They're not going to be up to the job." And when the African states refused to back him up on keeping Taiwan in the General Assembly after the mainland government, the communist government, took over the Chinese seat in the UN, Nixon said, "Goddamn cannibals." He calls them goddamn cannibals, cut off the foreign aid. See, now, he was also notorious for his ventilating of his spleen, you see. And his aides, including Brent Scowcroft, who I interviewed, said that they wouldn't act on a lot of the stuff that Nixon would say because they knew it was nonsense and that you'd get into all sorts of difficulties. And that, in part, was the problem with Watergate. They went ahead with something that they never should have.
Sure. If I may, please, yes. How would you contrast, and was it personal courage or just a sense of the country being behind him in some ways when, I was surprised to learn this, Nixon was the first president to visit Moscow.
Yes.
And on the way there, I am told that when they asked him if he wanted a fighter escort, he said something to the effect, "No, they damn well better not shoot me down." Contrast this, if you will, and if you, again, you think it's personal courage that Bush, for the relatively short history of Air Force One, was the first president to have a fighter escort and it was 9/11, where he disappeared for 8 hours, and for the first time in the history yes. of Air Force One, he had a fighter escort domestically. Do you think that's a personal courage or the lack
well,
of...
Well, let me speak to Nixon. Nixon was a man with courage. I mean, he went down in the late 50s, he went down to Latin America, South America, and he was in Caracas, Venezuela, where he was spat upon and stoned and was really quite courageous in the face of that assault. He came back to a hero's welcome at Andrews Air Force Base, and the wonderful anecdote is that Lyndon Johnson, who was Senate Majority Leader at the time, was out there to greet him, see him, greet him. And a week after this, a young reporter on Capitol Hill caught up with Johnson and said, Senator, I saw you out there at the Air Force Base embracing Vice President Nixon. I thought you told me a few weeks ago this guy Nixon was nothing but chicken shit. And Johnson said, son, what you got to understand is that in politics, overnight chicken shit can turn to chicken salad. As for Bush, I'll leave it to future historians.
Just a couple of superficial questions. I've never heard what in hell in Watergate was so important to Steele. Why did they, particularly who he sent in to do it? I mean, these are government people, CIA or whatever. And the second question, until you spoke tonight, I'd never heard that drugs or alcohol or whatever, that Nixon had resorted to that. He didn't seem to have a history of that. And I was wondering if that's something that came up and the public generally didn't know about it while Watergate was going on.
Well, the first point about Watergate, you know, in some ways Nixon was right when he said it was a third-rate burglary. I mean, what were they after? What did they hope to achieve? It was really a dumb thing to have done. And just as it was so dumb what Bill Clinton did. And so are these presidents always wise? Not by a long shot. The second part was... Nixon had a drinking problem. I mean, not because he drank so much, but because he couldn't hold his liquor. And John Ehrlichman, his domestic counselor, told him early on that if he didn't quit drinking, he wouldn't work in the campaign for him. Now, he did for a while, but once he got under the gun in Watergate, he was under such strain and stress, he would take a couple of belts of liquor, and that would... And that's why Kissinger would call him our drunken friend. He'd get on the phone and he'd be slurring his words. And so he did have a problem with alcohol. Yes, sir. Go ahead. Last question.
Yes, and I appreciate that. Just wondering, in terms of your work in the future and the historian's work in the future, you had tapes, you had memos, and there were letters. Now we got emails. And what are the implications of that for future historians? What percentage of communication now in the White House would you imagine is email, and how is that going to be saved? Are they making an effort to try to save that sort of thing?
Yeah, it is the issue that historians are vitally concerned about, because in a way these emails could be the tapes of the future. You know, we all do these emails, and people write ungrammatically, they write very hastily, but they are often quite revealing, and I think these White House emails may end up being a very rich source. But I don't know. When the first Bush left office, there was a court case in which they wanted to take away the electronic communications and be free to destroy them. And the historians, and political scientists, archivists, journalists, they sued and won the case in court. And the court said, you must not destroy these. These are presidential records. Now there's a flap going on over Rove's email and emails that were filtered through the Republican National Committee and where they were really doing government business. And these are presidential records. These are records which are mandated to be preserved. So I don't know what it's going to be like. This is going to be a very interesting, I mean, I wish I were around for the next 30, 40, 50 years to see how all this will come out, but I'm afraid I won't be, so I'll be up there in historian's heaven looking down on... Thank you.
Thank you.
He's like an old-fashioned so the American Army of Society of the and stands as she to serve as a press who can offer full switch to truth and fight and that time. As an election wise, he sent a plea of his warm-up and his deputy. Please, what we're trying to do.
you thank my son. Not the not the water, the